Thank you very much for inviting me. I looked at the challenge that Renata gave us, and I couldn't imagine what Leonardo da Vinci would do. Okay, so that may be my failure of imagination. But you know, if I thought about what he'd do, the first thing I'd do if I were him is buy a motorcycle and go tearing down the road at high speed to try to enjoy the new things life had given me. But what I really try to think of are the challenges that we face. And you'll see the themes here, I think, echo a lot of the other themes that were presented this morning. But really come down to understanding one fundamental thing. We talk about technology, we talk about new approaches to looking at medicine and looking at health and looking at research, and what we always come down to is each one of these technologies produces one and only one thing. And that single element is information. And the challenge we see time and again is that we're not producing new types of information. We're just producing the same types of information with slight variations, but at an astonishingly accelerated pace. We sequenced the first human genome in about 10 or 15 years, depending on when you actually believe it was finished from when they actually started it. We can now sequence that same genome in less than a week. And our ability to interpret the data, while the cost of a genome is falling well below $1,000, everyone agrees, within the next year or two, the cost of interpreting the data hasn't fallen nearly as fast. And the challenge is actually in interpreting the data, making sense of the data. And so I, in my work over the last few years, have really started to think about this overall problem of integrating data, integrating information, and using it to drive discovery. Okay? So medicine is largely focused on distinguishing disease based on physical characteristics, is the story you've heard today. What genomics has really shown us is that when we think of single diseases, they're often a spectrum of underlying molecular phenotypes. And probably the best example of that today is breast cancer, where even a few years ago, we talked about breast cancer as if it was a monolithic disease. But today, we recognize there are four or five distinct subtypes, and that those subtypes respond very different to therapies and, in fact, have their own tailored therapies. And four of the five, have reasonably good survival prognoses based on existing therapies, while one has particularly bad prognosis, and what we're trying to do is to understand that. These phenotypes and the molecular processes that drive them also dictate disease progression in response to therapy. So a large part of what we've been thinking about doing is actually using genomics as a lens to try to look at this problem of disease and disease stratification and disease differences. And one of the things you see, if you look at disease, is that what you'd really like to be in a position to do is to start from the very beginning and estimate the risk that individuals have for developing disease. You'd like to do better early detection. You'd like to stratify patients once you know they have disease, because that stratification can help, in fact, with staging and with predicting the proper treatment outcomes. Treatment options. If the treatments aren't going to perform well, what you'd like to do is know that so you can actually help patients make decisions that are going to improve their quality of life based on their own personal decisions and how they'd like to approach things. And again, we could talk about lots of different technologies. My research has been driven by genomic technology, so that's where I'll focus. And really, I think a big part of what's driven the field forward in genomic medicine is just the availability of DNA chips, commercially available chips that allow you to survey 50,000 genetic variants in a single assay, or to look at gene expression and to look at all 25,000 or 50,000 or however many genes and variants you think exist in the genome, to allow you to be able to make these kinds of decisions about the relative position of your patients or the individuals you're looking at throughout the spectrum of predicting their risk to helping them manage their healthcare decisions as their diseases progress. So what's been really interesting to me, even the last two or three years, is that while we're just starting to gain ground in dealing with this chip-based technology, the advent of DNA sequencing technologies has actually been extraordinarily disruptive scientifically. So I can take an instrument that would fit on top of this table and sequence your genome in less than a week. And that really changes the way we think about approaching basic problems in looking at disease, understanding the mechanism of disease. But more importantly, this technology is socially disruptive. It's changing the way we as a society think about how we manage our own personal health information. If I look at this and think about sequencing my genome for less than $1,000, and right now it's a little under $10,000 to do that, but if it was less than $1,000, what would I do? Nature, the scientific journal, actually did a survey in 2008 of prominent scientists, and they asked them what they would do with a $1,000 genome. And around about August, they ran out of prominent scientists, and they called me, and they'd asked me what I would do with a $1,000 genome. And I'd read everybody else's answers, and I talked to the reporter, and I said, well, do you want a scientific answer, or do you want an honest answer? And he said, I want an honest answer. I said, I'd sequence myself and my family. Right? For less than $1,000, having that kind of information would actually give me more ownership of my health care and my family's health care and their potential genetic risks, and potentially allow us to make decisions. But it also creates ethical challenges. My grandmother died of Alzheimer's. APOE mutations are known to be linked to Alzheimer's. What do I do if I carry an APOE mutation where there's no treatment? Right? How does that affect my quality of life? Do I really want to know that? And besides looking at all the issues associated with trying to make predictions about myself, if I sequence my genome and not my son's, I've actually sequenced half his genome. Who has the right to look at that data? Who has the right to look at that data? Who has the right to think about what that data means? And I think we as a society are really wrestling with that. But how do we take this vision of using genomics, using new technologies, and really allow it to drive healthcare and health research forward? The first thing we have to do is acquire access to patient samples and rational consent. And one of the points I make all the time when I talk to patients is that they're really our partners in research. But what we have to do is educate them about these issues associated with using their information and their data. We have to develop technology platforms. Just because we can sequence genomes doesn't mean we can interpret them. And we have to really think strategically about how we do that, which means we have to make information management and information integration a central mission. Because the genome sequence by itself isn't enough to actually interpret a patient's disease and understand what it means. And doing all of that, we realize we're only at the beginning steps, and so we have to conduct research as a vital component of making sense out of all of these data. We have to present the data back to the local community in ways that make sense. We have to, as scientists working in this area, enable research beyond our own. We have to realize that we only have limited capability as academics to do work and really bring in people from around the country, from around the world, from academia, from industry, from government, to make these processes work and work efficiently. And then coming back to really engaging patients as our partners, we have to communicate our mission to the broader community. So assuring access to samples is actually challenging, in part because there are a lot of issues associated with getting patients involved in research. Patients really want to be part of the process of curing disease. But there are things like informed consent that really have to be structured to allow those patients to be partners in the research process. And that actually presents a number of challenges just in terms of communicating what the relative risks are and communicating to our IRBs what relative risk actually means. HIPAA actually requires that we ensure patient confidentiality, and that means we can't release any kind of identifiable information when we publish studies. But what genomics has really done is taken identifiability and turned it on its head. Because if I sequence your genome, I have the best identifier of who you are available. And in fact, what we realize is you only need about 80 variant positions across your genome to uniquely identify you. So even if I do a limited survey of part of your genome focused on understanding what controls the regulation of a single gene, I may have sequenced enough of your genome to identify you. And that's really a moving target. How do we handle that data? How do we handle that information? My son is 4.5 years old. I guarantee you that when he's 15, his genome is going to be on Facebook or whatever kids use 15 years from now to share all their personal details. I guarantee you that when he meets his wife, it's not going to be through Match.com, it's going to be through GeneMatch.com. People are going to be using this data in different ways, in ways we can't even imagine. With a $1,000 genome in the age of Facebook, what all this means is really unclear. And so as I mentioned earlier, this new genomics has actually become a disruptive technology, and we really have to think through these issues carefully, and I don't think anybody has a clear answer to how we deal with that. We have to develop technology platforms, and you've heard part of the story before, so I'll be brief, but basically a few years ago, you could sequence a genome for a few billion dollars, like the Human Genome Project did, And if you do that, what you discover is that, or if you did it, you would discover it'd take rooms full of equipment and armies of people working flat out. And as I mentioned before, we can essentially sequence a genome. We did a genome earlier this year. It took about 6 weeks and cost us about $60,000. We could do it today in less than a week for less than $10,000. So the rate at which we're generating data from these technologies is still on an exponential climb. And as you heard, they're technologies that are promising $10 genomes within the next few years at rapid pace. What's been really astonishing about genome sequencing technology is it's essentially taken other technologies that were widely used in research and making their ways into the clinic and actually expanded the universe of what they can measure while increasing the complexity of the data. So that in fact, genomic technologies have taken over almost any area associated with nucleic acid analysis in patients and in research. So the challenge is that these new technologies in producing data and information are really transforming biological research and biomedical research from a laboratory science into an information science. Now, what we really need are new approaches to making sense of the data. The winners in the race to understand disease are really going to be those who can handle and interpret the information. So as part of our work, we really try to make information integration a central mission. So my group and I have long focused on this research problem of going from DNA to RNA to protein, from protein to understanding the networks, the systems biology you heard about. But ultimately, we want to be able to link that back to the patients who represent the phenotypes we're trying to understand. And we've been addressing this across the board. But a big part of what we've been trying to do is to actually look at building ways of dealing with this information overload. So we were actually approached with a problem that's not atypical in research hospitals or modern hospitals anywhere. We had some people who had clinical data, and they were running a clinical trial. They had patients enrolled in clinical trials. They were actually collecting genomic information from those patients. And within our hospital system at Dana-Farber, this clinical data lived in one domain, the research data lived in another domain, and there was no simple way to link them together. And so they came to me and they asked me if I had a solution to this problem. And the answer I had was that if you had data stores that wouldn't talk to each other, one way to do it would just be to pull out the relevant data from each and pull it into a central warehouse. And if you did that, what you could then do is pull in data from the public domain, and there's lots of public domain data, and then really use that together with clinical trials and new approaches like chemical biology and new imaging technologies to really synthesize the data and address the questions of better diagnostics, better therapies, more effective agents, the things that are really driving our efforts in biomedical research. So we got a $1 million commitment grant from the Oracle Corporation. We sat down and sort of mapped out how we would do this and built a strategic plan for implementing it. And what we actually discovered is that coming up with a plan took us about a year. Implementing it took about 3 months. And actually getting people to buy into sharing data and information took about 15 months. It was the single hardest problem we had. Because not only is the data fragmented, it's balkanized. The data is controlled by different people, all of whom are actively fighting to prevent its integration. Because people are afraid of what happens to the data when it gets out of their control. They have ownership of it, or they want to control it. They use things like HIPAA as a red herring to chase you away from actually bringing data together. And really negotiating the institutional barriers to sharing data was much harder than any other aspect of the project.